soul in sad exile was out on life's sea. So burdened with sin and distressed, till I heard a sweet voice saying, make me your choice. And I entered the haven of rest. I've anchored my soul in the haven of rest. I'll sail the wide sea. Tempest may sweep o'er the wild stormy deep, but in Jesus I'm safe evermore. I yielded myself to his tender embrace, and by faith, taking hold of God's word, my shackles, they all fell off, and I anchored my soul. Now the haven of rest is my Lord. Sees no more. The tempest may sweep o'er the wild stormy deep, in Jesus I'm safe evermore.
like to do that, that would be fine. That would be fine, so we'll just go right into the, okay. Let's see if we can announce that to everyone so they know what we're doing there. But make sure Mary Beth knows. Try to calm down and play the prayer. I have disinfected my hands so that the keys will not be. Let's all stand for Sing to the King.
Life and salvation. took our his children. In his arms he carries them all day long. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song. Praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. For our sins he suffered and bled and died. He our rock, our hope of eternal salvation. Hail him, Jesus the crucified. Sound his praises, Jesus who bore our sorrows. Love unbounded, wonderful, deep and strong. His excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song. Praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Heavenly portals, loud with hosannas ring. Jesus, Savior, reigneth forever and ever. Is coming over the world victorious. Power and glory unto the Lord belong. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song. Jesus, he's all we need. Lift up a heart of praise, sing now with voices raised to Jesus, sing to the King.
Our Father in heaven, we come into this place this morning to praise you, to worship you. Help us to lift your name up and give you glory. Thank you, Father, that we have the opportunity. Many people around the world do not have the opportunity to gather together. We thank you that we do. We ask that your Holy Spirit would help us this morning to draw close to you in all that we do, as we sing, as we pray, as we honor our graduates. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Good morning.
Good morning.
It is good to be with you this morning. I want you to know that this has been a busy weekend, and we thank you, all of those of you who helped prepare and clean up from the funeral yesterday for Ed Stewart, and we want to continue to remember Sharon and the family in our prayers. I have a quick announcement. Well, you have a bulletin that kind of tells you a couple of announcements that are in there, but we have another. There's a nominating committee meeting tomorrow evening at 6 p.m. if you're on that committee. Okay, just want you to know about that. Today is the day that we have chosen to honor our graduates. This year, because we have had this COVID problem, we haven't seen our high schoolers or junior hires, our children, for 6 months. But this morning, we've invited those who have graduated from high school this year and college to come and be with us. Well, there are six who we invited, but there's three who are able to attend. So this morning, we are going to give them a little pomp and circumstance, and they're going to come down the aisle and be seated here, and we're going to honor them. And so, let's have that special song. Come on in, guys. Welcome, gentlemen. In order to start this little service of recognition of our graduates, we have a video that we'd like you to watch. Turn up the volume. Need the volume. Okay, I hope you're good at lip reading. And we haven't had any practice of that because we've had to wear masks for so long. All right, well, it's not going to do us any good if we can't hear what they have to say. Our technical difficulties continue to haunt us. However, basically, the video related the fact that our seniors this year did not have the opportunity to have their prom. They didn't have the opportunity to do all of that senior stuff they should have been able to do. The senior breakfast or whatever it is. I don't know what all of the traditions are for you. But they had to make special arrangements for people to come in and watch them cross across the stage and receive their diploma. We're still dealing with all this craziness, but thankfully we're able to be together. But the gist of the rest of the video was, in spite of that, we are proud that our graduates have stuck it out and continued and have completed and now are ready to move on. Would you give them a round of applause before they even get up here? Graduates, come on up. Yeah, you come on up on the stage, and Gavin, you get down there, and I think Jeffrey, you're next, and Devin, you come up here first. We had, like I said, we had six that we wanted to honor, and one of them was Piper, and she was sick all night last night and didn't make it. So let's remember Piper in our prayers. Then after Piper is Devin Hall. So I told them, introduce yourself. Well, I just introduced him, so you don't have to do that. Devin, would you tell us, where did you go to high school?
Went to Magnolia High School.
To Magnolia. And what are your plans?
Go to college soon and get a degree in diesel mechanics.
Diesel mechanics. So which college are you, do you have an idea where you want to go to school?
Washington State in Marietta.
Washington State in Marietta. Okay, and they have a diesel program mm-hmm. there. Very good. Thank you. Step right over here, so let Jeffrey come in front of this microphone. Now I'm going to make you introduce yourself.
I'm Jeffrey Schaefer.
And you graduated, obviously, from?
Magnolia High School.
Yeah. So tell us, what is your plans?
To go to the United States Marine Corps.
The Marine Corps? When are you leaving?
May 8th.
So you have got a few months before that, and you're all signed up and ready to go? Congratulations. Sir. We're proud of you.
Thank you.
Introduce yourself.
I'm Gavin Morris.
And Gavin, you graduated from?
Tyler Consolidated.
Tyler, okay. And what are your plans?
I'm currently in my first semester at Pierpont Community and Technical College in Fairmont in efforts to become an electrical technician.
Electrical technician. So how long is this gonna take you?
It's a 2-year degree. First semester ends November 20th, so I'll be a quarter of the way done.
He's already counting it. That's fantastic. Well, we're proud of you all. Now, we have a gift for you each, but we're going to let you have it after the service. We're going to have a reception outside of the doors, and we'll let you have that gift when we get out there. There's one more thing that I want you to to stand up here for, and that's a reading that the congregation is going to do. Congregation, we have some words that are going to be on the screen, and we want you to, if you would, stand up and charge these young men with this graduation reading. Let's read it together.
Your graduation is a proud day for you and a dream come true for your family. We share in your joy as together we celebrate what God has done in your life. We pray that you will go on to what God has already planned, for you have such an awesome future when you place it in God's hands. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Jeremiah 29:11.
Would you bow your heads with me as we pray for these people? Father in heaven, I thank you that we have the opportunity to honor these guys and even the ladies who weren't able to make it today. I ask for your blessing on each one of them, Lord. I ask that you would help them as they are stepping forward into their future. I pray, dear Father, that you would help them to keep their eyes on you. And Lord, that whatever they do, that they will serve you. Whatever their plans are, Lord, that they will be seeking after your kingdom. Thank you, Lord, for them. We ask that you fill them with your Holy Spirit. Help them as they go along their way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, guys. You can be seated. And I just want to say, I'm throwing a curve to Don here. I do want us to recognize the ladies who couldn't make it here today. So Miklin Richmond, you'll know Miklin because she is the daughter of Mike and Marcia, and so she graduated from college this year. Which college was it? West Liberty. And she couldn't be here today because she had to work. And the other one, that's a good picture. The other one is Gracie Greenlee. And she attended here a while back, and then she started attending again this past fall. And we thought it appropriate to recognize her today also. And she graduated from River High School, but for whatever reason, she could not make it today. So we want to remember them also. We have a special song now as we prepare our hearts for prayer. Now, no, in no way are we stopping our recognition of our graduates, and we want for this service to honor them, continue to honor them. So let's prepare our hearts for prayer.
Who made the winters and the summers, the one who put the stars all into place, the only one who stands above all others, he knows me by name.
Can you believe that?
Angels hide their faces in his presence. The demons run for cover when you speak. You rule the world, reign above the heavens, and still draw close to me. And when I know I'm praying to a God who my troubles down at his feet. It's amazing that the Savior and the Father, he is a friend to me. How can it be, oh, I'm not just hoping, I'm not just wishing.
Thank you.
We do thank the Lord for all that He has given to us. This morning, we have to some people that we want to remember in prayer. We've had a phone call from the Amen Corner over at the nursing home. And Brother Andy and Brother Don and our sister, I can't think of her name, Diane. They are struggling because they haven't been out. They haven't been able to come, and they really need our prayers. So let's lift them up this morning as we go to the Lord. Again, I want us to remember the Stewart family. Betty Campbell had her surgery this past week and went very successfully. She was able to come to the funeral yesterday, but needs to be careful about how much she is out. We want to remember the rest of those who are listed here on our bulletin. Bob and Linda Gray. Linda struggling with the kidney disease. Ardell Howell, Bill and Barb Starkey, Peggy Johnson, Sharon Ensinger, Winfred Howell. We're glad for Patty. She's been recently married. They had their celebration yesterday, but she still has a lot of physical ailments. We want to continue to remember her. Let's continue to remember Linda Doretta Rush's daughter. We do have a praise that she has been doing better, but the last we heard, but let's continue to pray for her. For Teresa Gilbert, who at this point is very sick. As you can see, all of the names listed there. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Would you stand with me? I'm certain that you have concerns that you want to take to the Lord. And maybe just by raising your hand and saying, yes, I have a concern that I want to bring to the Lord this morning. Let's bow our heads. Our Father in heaven, you understand everything that is going on in this world. You understand everything that's going on in our lives, everything that's going on even in our town, in our community. And regardless of what's going on, regardless of the struggles that we are facing, Lord, we thank you that you still care for us. We ask, dear Lord, that you would help us to always seek after you. Lord, this morning we thank you once again for our graduates. We ask again for your blessing upon their lives. Lord, we pray specifically this morning for Diane and Don and Andy who are struggling and all the rest who are in the nursing home next door as they are struggling so much with not being able to get out. Lord, I can't imagine what it's like to be penned up all this time, not to be able to come and join in with their church family, Lord. We ask for your encouragement this morning. We ask, dear Lord, that you would bless them. Help us, Lord, inspire us to communicate with them, to send them cards and letters and do window visits and the type of thing that you would have us as your people to do. Lord, we know that there are many who are struggling with not being able to get around because of the threat of this virus. And so we ask, Lord, for the rest of our church family who are shut in, those who their bodies are weak and they are threatened. Lord, I pray for your strength for them today and your encouragement. Lord, we lift up the names that are on our list this morning, and we ask, dear Jesus, that you would touch these bodies. Lord, for Linda Gray, for for Ardell Howell. Lord, for both Bill and Barb Starkey as they're struggling. Lord, we pray for Peggy. We ask that you would strengthen her body. For Sharon Ensinger, Lord, we thank you for the good news about Betty, but we ask that you would continue to work in her life and to heal her. Lord, we pray for Winfred. We ask that he would be able to be strengthened, Lord, that you would strengthen his legs and his body. Help him, Lord. We pray again for Patty, Lord, that you would strengthen her. Help her and her new husband, that they would find joy in each other. Bless them, I pray, dear Father. Now, Lord, I ask that you would help us as your church, the First Church of God in New Martinsville. I pray, dear Lord, that you would help us to know how that we can best not only minister to each other, but minister to our community, to reach out to a lost and a dying world. Help us, Lord. Inspire us. Father, I pray that you would lay on our hearts those whom we, as individuals, need to speak to invite to come to church, or just invite over for a piece of pie or a cup of coffee, just to have a conversation and to share our love, your love, with them. Lord, help us to be able to break past the barriers that have been put up by this virus so that we can have the relationships with each other that you want us to have. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I know that there are people on our hearts and minds, and right now we speak the names of those that we are each thinking of. Father, I ask that now that you would help us as we hear from your word and are encouraged by what you have to say. In Jesus' name, amen. Worship team. My message this morning is to all of us, yet it's slanted a little bit towards our graduates. And the question I ask specifically would be a question that you would ask somebody in early in their life, but I think all of us can appreciate it. So the question is, what is your greatest desire? What is your greatest desire? What is it that you really want out of life? What do you want to get in this life? What is your heart set on? Well, by the answers to some of the questions we had for our guys this morning, we heard mechanics, we heard Marines, we heard electrical engineer. These are career paths, hopefully that get you to a place in life. But what I'm asking is, what do you really want? And what will you do when you get it? Have you thought about that? What is it that you really want? Well, I want to be a rich man. I remember being a child and having a calendar my grandfather gave me, and every month of the calendar had an antique car on it. And I thought, oh, those cars are so cool. I'd like to have one of those. And I got to dreaming a little bit, and I thought, now I would like to have one of those for every day of the week, a different one. Now, why is that? Why would I desire? I don't know. It's just cool. Well, of course, if you had a different classic car for every day of the week, that meant you had a little money or were severely in debt. But that when you have something like that, it kind of shows off that you are somebody, that you're significant, that you have a little bit of money, that and you can be recognized by other people. People notice when you drive by. And by the way, I had that dream before Jay Leno was ever known. Okay, those of you who know who Jay Leno is, and all the cars that he has. Anyways, I want to ask you this question. Regardless of what your deepest desire is, did you know that Jesus is interested in giving you what you want? Let me say it again. Jesus is interested in giving you what you want. Now, I'm not talking about Jesus being this genie that you rub the lamp and he comes out and says, oh, you've got three wishes. That's not who Jesus is. Okay, but he is interested in giving you, fulfilling the desires of your heart. But we need to be thoughtful about what we really want and why we want it. Jesus wants to give us what we want if what we want is right for us. So we need to kind of think about that. Is what we want right for us? Well, there's a story in Mark chapter 10 of Jesus walking through the town of Jericho, and he's got crowds and crowds of people around him. He's just a big, huge crowd, but there's a blind man by the name of Bartimaeus who is on the edge of the crowd, and he realizes who Jesus is, and he wants to be healed. And so he's crying out, Jesus, Son of God, Jesus of Nazareth, help me, help me. And Jesus hears his cries over the rumble of the crowd, and he stops and says, bring that man to me. And Jesus asks him, what do you want? And Bartimaeus said, I want to see. And Jesus looks back at him and says, your faith has healed you. Now go and see. And this man was instantly healed. And you know what he did with that? Then he followed Jesus. Jesus knew that being able to see was good for this man. What do you want me to do for you? That's what Jesus asks us. Have you told him that lately? What you want him to do for you? Have you actually prayed those words? Lord, I'd like for you to do this for me. And you know what? There's some things that we should ask for, and there's some things that maybe we need to be careful about what we ask for. Sometimes what we ask for isn't good for us. There's a story of how they catch monkeys in Africa. There's native hunters in the jungles of Africa. They have a very clever way of trapping monkeys. They would trap them and sell them perhaps, or whatever they would use the monkeys for. But first, the first thing they do is they take a coconut and they slice it in two, and they kind of hollow it out, and they drill a hole just so big in one half of that. And then they take an orange and they put it in the two halves, and they fasten the two halves together, and they fasten with a rope of some sort, they fasten that coconut to a tree. And the orange inside, being ripe and having a lot of good smell to it, draws and attracts the monkey. And the monkey then comes and he smells that orange inside, so he sticks his hand inside that little hole to grab the orange and try to pull it out. The problem is, the hole is too small for him to get his hand out while he's holding onto the orange. So he continues to hold on and pull, and now he's trapped. He's trapped by the desire for that orange. And all they have to do is throw a net over him, and they've got their monkey. I don't think that orange was a good thing for that monkey. It trapped him. Jesus wants to help us understand how to want what is good for us. Our scripture this morning is in Matthew chapter 6, and it's printed in your bulletin. And if you'd like to read it along with me, I invite you just to open your bulletin up and let's study this for a minute. Jesus is talking to his disciples, all of the followers, and he's telling them, he says, don't store up treasures here on earth where moths eat them and rust destroys them and where thieves break in and steal. We know what that kind of treasure is, right? That physical treasure. He says, store your treasures in heaven where moths and rust cannot destroy and thieves do not break in and steal. And then he says this very important phrase. He says, wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will be also. Whatever you consider a treasure, that is what your heart will desire. Jesus is telling us we need to think about what we actually treasure. And then he goes on to say, your eye is like a lamp that provides light for your body. And when your eye is healthy, your whole body is filled with light. But when your eye is unhealthy, your whole body is filled with darkness. And if the light you think you have is actually darkness, how deep that darkness is. All right, what in the world is Jesus talking about here? What do you mean your eye is like a lamp? Well, let me explain this to you. The Jewish people had an expression. When they said someone has healthy eyes, that meant that they were a generous person, that they were a good person. They were not a selfish person. But when they said that someone has a bad eye, they were saying that a person was stingy, that they were selfish, that they were living only for their own gain. And so Jesus is using that expression, and he's saying that if you are focused on a selfish desire, if you have a bad eye, you're actually living in darkness. Selfishness brings darkness to our lives. Listen as he goes on to explain. He says, no one can serve two masters, for you will hate one and love the other. You will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and be enslaved to money. Okay, there I said it. Money. Is that not something we want? Who does not want any money? All right, I will forego all money, right? No. Well, first of all, we know we've got to have something to live on, right? But it's the love of money that Jesus says is the root of all evil. Verse 25. Well, let me say that again. You cannot serve God and be enslaved to money. That is why I tell you not to worry about everyday life, whether you have enough food and drink or enough clothes to wear. Isn't life more than food? Isn't your body more than clothing? Look at the birds. They don't plant or harvest or store food in barns, for your heavenly Father feeds them. Aren't you far more valuable to Him than they are? Can all your worries add a single moment to your life? And why worry about your clothing? Look at the lilies of the field and how they grow. They don't work or make their clothing. Yet Solomon, in all of his glory, was not dressed as beautifully as they are. And if God cares so wonderfully for wildflowers that are here today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, He will certainly care for you. Why do you have so little faith? So don't worry about these things, saying, what will we eat? Or what will we drink? What will we wear? These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers. But your heavenly Father already knows all your needs. And here's the next key statement. So He says, seek the kingdom of God above all else. Live righteously, and He will give you everything that you need. So don't worry about tomorrow. For tomorrow will bring its own worries. Today's trouble's enough for today. Now, don't misunderstand this to say that Jesus is saying you don't have to get a job. All right? I tried that once. No, not really. No, actually, the Bible tells us that those who don't work shouldn't eat. You know, we're not supposed to be moochers. That's not at all what He's saying. But Jesus is telling us that if we make our treasure something that is self-serving, we will end up feeling empty, living in darkness, and maybe even be trapped like that poor monkey. He's telling us to take our eyes off of ourselves. And Psalm 37:4 says, take delight in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Take delight in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. So I ask again, the desires of your heart? What is that? Well, first of all, let me tell you that God will give you the desires of your heart in two ways if you take delight in Him. The first way is He will place godly desires in you. So He's giving you the desires of your heart. He's going to place a godly desire in you. And then the second way is He will fulfill that desire. He's going to help you want the godly things. And then He's going to give you the things that you're desiring, the things that you want. But let's go back to that first phrase, take delight in the Lord. What does that mean? How do you delight in the Lord? Well, basically, it means that you're living for Him, that you make living for Him your first priority. You allowed Him to guide you in your life decisions. You see that Jesus gives you the most joy. You take delight in Him. You recognize what He has done for you, and you continue to give Him glory for all of that. You know what? Sometimes it's easy, especially in the Christian family, and you come to church every week, and you hear us talking about Jesus dying on the cross. Well, you know, that's a pretty familiar statement. And we come in and we see the cross up here, and the cross has become a very familiar symbol in our world. And I'm going to guess that every time you see a cross, you don't think about what it actually means. Every time I say the phrase, well, Jesus died on the cross to pay for your sins, you don't go into the process of thinking about what that actually means. We just kind of get numb to it. We know what it means, and so we don't feel what it means all the time. But if we take delight in the Lord, then we continually remember what He has done for us. And we have a joy in thinking about the love He has for us. So, we take delight in the Lord and we allow Him to guide us in our life decisions. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously. That's what He says. God is asking you to make a total commitment when He tells you to do that. To seek the kingdom of God above all else. That's making a commitment. That's what we talk about, making a commitment to God. And He promises that He's not going to leave you alone. He will give you everything you need. All right, so we talk often about the kingdom of God. And you know what? Since I first came here, I've been talking about the kingdom of God. What exactly is the kingdom of God? Let me explain it this way. We have our graduates with us this morning, and I'm guessing most all of you have graduated from high school someplace. How many of you graduated from Magnolia? How many of you graduated from Tyler? How many of you have graduated from some other high school? Not around here, or not real close to here. Yeah, and so let me just break it down this way. In order to graduate from your school, you had to complete the coursework. You had to fulfill the requirements. There were requirements laid out for you by your teachers and your administrators, and you had to fulfill all those requirements. Remember that, guys? Was that a push to do that? Was that a challenge? It was a little more of a challenge for some of us than others, I'm sure. Only people who fulfilled the requirements could be graduates. And only people who graduated from your high school can call themselves an alumni of your school. There's not another one of you in here who are alumni from Conotton Valley Junior High, Senior High School, where I graduated from. You can't be a part of that class because you graduated from someplace else. You can't be a part of that alumni. However, is there anybody else in here who graduated in 1978? All right! We're from the same class, aren't we? 1978. And this morning, our graduates are from the graduating class of 2020. Only people from high school who graduated in 2020 can claim that they are from the class of 2020, from your particular high school. And I'm pretty sure that each one of us feel a close bond with the other students in the class from our school. We've most likely experienced many life-changing things together. We've been living as a member of the class of 2020. This group is the class of 20 now of that high school. And now that you're graduated, you no longer have to attend high school, but you will always be a member of that graduating class of 2020 or 1978 or let's see. Let me. What was that? 1957? Yeah, that's what I thought. Any other 1957s in here? All right, that's all right. Let me just stop for a second. Is there anybody who graduated before 1957? Just wondering, is there anybody in here who graduated? Well, I thought you had the record there, Dad. Here's the thing. Your high school is not the only one who has people who graduated in the year that you graduated. There are schools all around the state who have a graduating class this year of 2020. Right? There's public schools, there's private schools, there's home schools, there's charter schools. But you have at least one thing in common with all of those people, and that is that you graduated from high school in the same year. Right? But your state is not the only state who has people who have graduated in the year of 2020. Gavin, think of that. Kids all over the country graduated this year, had the same conditions. Jeffrey, let's see, when was the last day that you actually walked through the doors of school attending class? Middle of March someplace, wasn't it? Only the class of 2020 has that in their memory banks, right? But there are schools all across the country. Every one of us has at least one thing in common with people all across the country, and that's that we are in the same graduating class. But our country is not the only country who has people who have graduated this year, the year of 2020, or the year of 1978, or whatever your year is. There are schools all around the world who have graduating class of 2020. And you guys have at least one thing in common with all of those people, and that is that you graduated from high school in the same year. I think that you understand that you are a member of the class, guys, of 2020, or whatever your high school class is. That can't be taken away from you. You are a member of that class. The kingdom of God is something like your graduating class. Your class is your graduating class has no rooms now. Once you graduate, you don't have to go back to high school, right? You don't have to attend there anymore. And so, but your class still is considered the class of whatever your year is. It has no rooms, has no walls, it has no boundaries. It's not organized politically. It just has people of all different nationalities and cultures and backgrounds. And you all have at least one thing in common, that's you graduated from the same year. And that's kind of the way the kingdom of God is. It has no rooms, it has no walls or boundaries. It's not organized politically, although many people have tried. It has people of all different nationalities and cultures and backgrounds. And they all have at least one thing in common. The people in the kingdom of God have this one thing in common. They have a relationship with Jesus Christ, the King of the kingdom. Yes, the kingdom of God has a king. The king is Jesus, the Son of God. And the reason that he gets to be the king is because he's the only one who could meet the requirements of living in God's kingdom. He had no sin in his life. When God the Father created this world, he created man to have a relationship with him in his kingdom. But we all know how Adam and Eve messed that up, don't we? They sinned. They were disobedient to God. And they ate the fruit from the tree of life, of knowledge of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. They ruined it for everyone who would come after them. And because of their sin, all the rest of us are born into a sinful world that causes us to sin before we even know what we're doing. We all have the curse of being disobedient to God. And the sin we have committed keeps us from the right to enter into the perfect, sinless kingdom of God. In fact, because we are disobedient, we must face the punishment of our disobedience. We are therefore condemned to death for being disobedient. That means we're separated from God and His kingdom forever. I want you to think about that for a second. Take a look inside. Are you a member of the kingdom? Or do you stand outside of the kingdom as one of those who are condemned to go to hell, to be separated from God for eternity? But God, who created the world, is a God of justice and mercy. And He loved the people of the world so much that He sent His one and only Son, Jesus, who had no sin. He sent Him into the world to show us how to live in this sinful world, to show us how to live with love for God and for each other, and to take our place in the punishment that we deserve for the sins that we've committed. He took our punishment by voluntarily dying on the cross, because Jesus had no sin in Him. His perfect life was enough to pay for our sinful lives. Scripture says, whoever believes in Jesus with both your mind and your heart, whoever believes in Him will not be condemned to eternal death, but could have eternal life as a citizen of the kingdom. So how do you truly believe in Jesus with both your mind and your heart? How does that truly happen? Especially if you haven't had a chance to really meet Him. Well, how do you actually go about meeting the King of Kings at all? The answer is, He's the one who wants to meet you. He's the one who wants to meet you. That's the reason why He came, to bring you into His kingdom, to give you new life that is full of joy and excitement and lasts eternally. So Jesus invites us to have a relationship with Him so that we can believe in Him and become a citizen of His kingdom. In order to be a citizen of the kingdom of God, you have to have a relationship with the King. Now let me tell you something. This is why this is important. Jesus doesn't want to be just another friend in your life. He doesn't want you to just put His name in your list of contacts, and so that when you're feeling like it, you just kind of go, oh, I wonder what Jesus is doing today. Give Him a call. Now, Jesus doesn't want to be just a part of your life. He's the King of all kings. He's the Creator of all things, you see. He wants to have a relationship with you that is so close to Him that you make Him and His kingdom number one in your life. That you delight in Him. That you desire to be with Him, to please Him. And then He will give you the desires of your heart. That's why He said in Matthew 6:33, seek the kingdom of God above all else, and live righteously. And when you do, He promises He will give you everything you need. You may say, oh, but I'm young. I have my whole life ahead of me. I want to experience some things. I want to have some fun. I want to live my life. And that's what God wants you to do. God wants you to live your life. He wants you to have fun. He wants you to experience things. But He created you to live in relationship with Him. And only when you live in a relationship with Him can you experience fully what God has created you to experience. And the other things that of this world that you might go through, God didn't intend many of those things for us. Those things are a simple pleasure-seeking things. Graduates, you've struggled all your life to gain your independence. And now here I am telling you that you need to depend upon God. I just want to give a little illustration of that. There's a little girl, cheerful little girl with curls down on her shoulders, and she's almost 5 years old, and she was waiting with her mother in the checkout line, and she saw this little package hanging by the checkout counter right at eye level. You know how they do. The package, it didn't have candy in it, but it had this little necklace in it of fake pearls. And she saw that, and it really jumped out at her, and she wanted that. And she says, "Oh, Mommy, please, can I have them, please, Mommy, please?" And her mother checked the back of the little box and said, "Well, Jenny, these pearls cost, are you ready for this? $1.95. If you really want them, I'll think of some extra chores for you to do and raise your allowance. And it won't take long for you to save enough money for you to buy them for yourself." And for her mom was right. After only 2 weeks, Jenny had enough money saved up, and she was able to buy those pearls. They went to the store, and she laid out the money, counted it out in front of the cashier, and purchased her beautiful necklace. Jenny loved her little pearls. They made her feel pretty and grown up. She wore them everywhere, Sunday school, kindergarten, even to bed. The only time she took them off was when she went swimming or took a bath. Her mother said that if they got wet, they might turn her neck green or something, you know. Well, Jenny also had a very loving daddy. And every night when she was ready for bed, her daddy would stop whatever he was doing, and he would come upstairs to read her a story. And one night, he finished the story, and he said to Jenny, "I love you, sweetheart. Do you love me?" "Oh, yes, Daddy," Jenny replied. "You know that I love you." And then her father said something very strange. He said, "Then give me your pearls." "What?" Jenny was confused. "Oh, Daddy, not my pearls," she said. But you can have Princess, the white horse from my collection. You remember, Daddy? The one you gave me last year? She is my favorite horse." "Oh, no, that's okay, honey," Jenny's father said. "Daddy loves you. Good night." And he brushed cheek with a kiss. About a week later, after story time, Jenny's daddy said once again, I sure do love you, sweetheart. Do you love me?" "Oh, Daddy, you know I love you." "Well, then Jenny, give me your pearls." Jenny was confused again. "Oh, Daddy, well, not my pearls, but you can have my baby doll. The brand new one I got for my birthday. She's so beautiful, and you can have the yellow blanket that matches her sleep too." "No, that's okay," Jenny's father said. "Daddy loves you. Good night." And as always, he gave her a gentle kiss. A few nights later, when Jenny's daddy came in the room, She was sitting on her bed with her legs crossed. And as he came close, he noticed her little chin was just quivering. And he said, "Honey, what's the matter?" As the tears started to run down her face, "What is it, Jenny? What's wrong?" Jenny didn't say anything for a minute, but lifted up her little hand to her daddy. When she opened it, there was her little pearl necklace. So with one hand, her dad took the necklace from her. And with the other hand, he reached into his pocket and he pulled out and put something else in her hand. And when he opened and let go, it was a brand new real pearl necklace. That's what God wants to do for us. That's what Jesus wants to do for us. Surrender all of those worldly desires, and I'll give you something real. I want to give you something real. Mark 8:35 says, "If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake and for the sake of the good news, you will save it. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Is anything worth more than your soul? Not at all. So I ask you, what is your greatest desire? Did you know that Jesus is interested in giving you what you really want? So what are you seeking? The pleasures of this world or the kingdom of God? We need to be thoughtful about what we really want and why we want it. Jesus promises to give us the desires of our hearts if we make him first in our lives. It's my challenge for you this morning. Worship team, come on up. I would like us to think this morning as we sing, have I placed Jesus first in my life? Have I given over all of my fake pearl necklace to him? So that I can receive from him the beauty of the real thing that he has for me.
You've been are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Worthy is your name.
I just want to tell you that because of our COVID restrictions, I don't often make an invitation to come and use the altar, but the altar really is open anytime. However, I'm a firm believer that just because the Holy Spirit is speaking to you in some way, if you walk out the door, doesn't mean you've escaped Him. No, the message is something that you take home with you and you think about. Decisions are not made to follow Christ in a flash. No, those decisions are made through contemplation and through understanding. And sometimes that decision is a process. I hope that you are praying for each other, as every one of us are in the constant process of making the decision to be a Christ follower every single day. Every single day. Graduates, we want to honor you outside. So as we dismiss this morning, we're going to you guys can go ahead and go on out. Tarina, I think Tarina's already out there. She's got things set up out underneath the awning out here as you go outside. And you can grab a cupcake and leave a card and just tell these guys congratulations. Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank you once again for being our Savior, for being our King. And I pray, Lord, that you would help us to always decide to be a member of your kingdom. Lord, help us to always have you as the desire of our heart. Now help us now as we go from this place to live for you in all that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let's dismiss from the back first.